frown looking up something. I got one of my favorite songs, "How Oh How He Loves You and Me." Right? How's that, huh? Is that good? All right. Let's do it. All right. Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
It's good to be here. Right? It's always good to serve the Lord. You know, there's always one way to start out the day, and that's starting out loving God. That's always the way to start your day. I found out when you take those few minutes in the beginning of the day, how the day goes a lot better. It doesn't mean there's things that won't happen throughout the day, but God is with you. That's one thing we always got to remember. And I woke up and this song was actually one that, you know, sometimes you wake up and songs just run through your mind, you know. And I remember hearing this years ago, and it just really, really got to me. And this morning, this song, I was getting ready for work, and this song was coming back. And I remember it was in a movie, and I remember, and I want to share this with you. And it goes, the song is, "Oh, How He Loves You and Me." Isn't that powerful? If you can just get that down inside of you, how much God really loves you, a lot of the problems and concerns we have just wash away. The problem we get into trouble is we think God doesn't love us, or we get there, all this trouble's befallen me, you know, all this stuff, you know. But in reality, our lives are so blessed. Even when things don't go right, they're still blessed. Count your blessings. You know, on Facebook, one person said that you ought to count your blessings more than you do your sorrows. You know, they can't never balance. You know, you put something on the scale and you put all the blessings on one side, they'd always weigh it down, you know. Because what we look at is, you look at all the blessings, they're heavy because they rain down on us all the time. But what we do, we want to put all the heartaches and pain on us, all the other side, you know, and just clobber it with that. But we got to look at the fact every single day God blesses us. And I just want to share this. Oh, how he loves you and me. Oh, how he loves you and me. Oh, how he loves you and me. He gave his life. What more could he give? Oh, how he loves you. Oh, how he loves me. Oh, how he loves you and me. Isn't that powerful? Jesus to Calvary did go, his love for mankind to show. What he did there, bro, hope from despair. Oh, how he loves you. Oh, how he loves me. Oh, how he loves you and me. We should never forget that. And Psalms 119, I want to share one verse that really, or a couple verses that really, Psalms 119, that really encapsulate how God looks at us. Because, you know, he gave us commandments. He gave us the Bible for a reason, so that we have direction. Now, if you got anything that you've had to put together and you think you could put it together without the directions, you know, it come out looking some strange stuff, let me tell you. I remember years ago, brother, we always was like brothers growing up, but he was trying to train the brake pads on his car, you know, and everything looked good. You know, you take them off, we're not mechanics, but suddenly we realized there's some parts left, okay? Well, that means there's something not right. Give us some parts left, they had them on there for a reason. So then we had to take off the other tire on the other side and look at the brakes on the other side, see how it's put together. And I determined right there, I'm going to make enough money to go to the mechanic and let him fix the car. I've been doing it ever since. I go to the person that knows how to do it. And that's the way God is. Think about that. He already knows. It's already settled. Let's look at this, Psalms 119. I'm starting verse 86 and read a few. All your commandments are faithful and sure. Isn't that powerful? God's word is sure. The godless pursue and persecute me with falsehood. Help me, Lord. They had almost consumed me upon earth, but I forsook not your precepts. According to your steadfast love, give life to me. Then I will keep the testimony of your mouth, hearing, receiving, loving, and obeying it. That's where it comes from. That's where the power comes from. And I love this next verse. This is where we should all be. Forever, O Lord, your word is settled in heaven. stands firm as the heavens. And I'm going to go to 90. Your faithfulness is from generation to generation. You have established the earth, and it stands fast. Hallelujah.
Yes.
How powerful is that? God's word's already settled. I love that. He already has a plan for your life.
Yes.
Okay? That's when we go back, oh, how he loves you and me. He loves us so much. You know, it's like when you have kids and they got the one thing about kids, you know, I think it was in the 70s when they had the kids, the paintings with the kids with the big eyes, you know. Yep. They was normal, they had these great big eyes, and their eyes would just look at you no matter where you went. Sometimes kids have them big sad eyes. It's hard to get mad at your kid and done something, and they look up with them poor sad eyes. And you know, whatever they want, you're still gonna give it to them. You try to be tough. But it doesn't work, you know, because you got a soft heart. You understand they're kids. You know, I was out driving today, and this is a new class. So when it's a new class, I mean, it's the third day in the truck. So it's a lot to learn yet. OK, and I'm always amazed when somebody says, oh, Tim, man, you got such patience and you're out here. I appreciate. And you know what? Whenever they say that, I don't get a big head. You know what I think? I thank God. Because I remember when I didn't have much patience. And you know, when you're doing driver's ed, now just imagine you're doing driver's ed or teaching your kids to drive, multiply that by a 40-ton vehicle. I mean, it's a whole lot different, you know, to be out there in that big truck. But, you know, every time I hear that, I just thank God. I thank God that he gave me that ability. You know, I think back in 1976 when I started. Now, 40 years later, and he gives it my ability. And you know what? Being a teacher is one of the greatest callings for a simple reason. We're all teachers. Because I guarantee you, somebody's watching your behavior.
Yeah.
Just the time you think nobody's watching you, somebody is watching you. Mm-hmm. You know, I know I said this before, but Moses always, it just gets me that when he killed the Egyptians and put them in the sand, it always kills because the Bible said he looked this way and that way. You know, and then he did it. But the problem was he didn't look up. I mean, that would have solved everything. If he looked up, what am I doing? Because you know what? Whatever we decide to do in our life, when we got these plans, we need to run it through God first. The problem is we just go ahead and do something, ask God to bless us, you know, and then when it gets all messed up, God deliver me, you know. Well, it don't work. It don't work as good that way. The way it works is if we go to God first, that make a difference. He can tell you what neighborhood you should live in. He can tell you what the best job is for you. He can, you know, he can tell you the person that you need to spend your life with. You know, he can tell you all those things ahead of time. But that's where we always got to be. If God loves you, which he does, why don't we go to him first and ask him? The reason I believe some people don't ask God first, because he might say no.
Yeah.
That's the reason.
Yeah.
You know, it's in my heart, man. I really love that person. I really love that person. I remember going out to Philadelphia, and I know I shared this before, but I was going out to Philadelphia, and at the time I was by myself. I wasn't married, and when I flew out there, and my daughter was out there, and it was on a Wednesday. Now, there's no way unless she said something, but the pastor wasn't going to tailor a sermon just for me. So he's at church out in Philadelphia, and he was talking about being single and wanting to get with somebody. He said, what you need to do is pray that God show you that person's heart first.
Yes, amen.
And I thought, what a simple thing. That is so simple, right? But people don't do that. They, you know, they like them, they fall in love with them first, and then they kind of get down the line, and they might ask God farther down the line. By that time, they might not ask him, or may ask him, but the heart done got pulled in there, you know? And sometimes you don't hear that call. You know, you don't hear, but God will say, no, I understand. Let's just wait a while. Sometimes it's not no on situations. Sometimes it's just wait a while, okay? Because I need to grow you inside. I need to mature you. Why don't they give a driver's license to a 10-year-old? Okay? Now, physically, some of them are big enough at 10 or 11, 12. I mean, they're out driving tractors and stuff. They could drive a car, right? But you got to get the maturity to understand those things. So now you start 14, you give them a permit. You don't give them a full-fledged license, and they learn. What God does is he's a wonderful and is a smart God, and he understands, I'm not going to give you all stuff right now. Let's grow into that. Let's learn, okay, so that we can be mature. The things we go through, the thing about how God has dealt with us, God uses all those circumstances. You know, Paul talked about it. He comforts us with the same comfort so we can give somebody else. See, there's something that people can never deny that, you know what, I understand how you feel. See, I can identify with a lot of things, you know. I've been through it. When somebody says, I know how you feel, brother. I've been there. Well, how'd you get through it? Well, I'll tell you how I got through it. You know, I sought the Lord. That's it. You know, and so is there some great secret about getting through this life? I tell you what, when you look at old saints has been in the Lord for a long time, one thing they've learned, good or bad, they learned to trust God. That's why I was thinking about my mom today, and she would have been now over 100 years old. But one thing she'd always talk about, she said, Tim, the Bible ain't wrong. She'd always say that, the Bible ain't wrong. And it said, I don't know what people do without the Lord. She would always say that. She would always pray. I mean, if I had a prayer request, her and my aunt Louise, they get on that phone and they pray about it. And we had Bible study at home, and she loved Bible study because she could ask questions. She would stand up. We had Bible study at home, and when I was down big, she'd always stand up and raise her hand. You know, she looked like she was in school because she loved studying the Word of God. What better gift can you give to somebody than the Word of God? What's the best thing? And tell them how much they love them. I'm telling you, there's a lot of people in this world that do not think that anybody loves them. There's a lot of people in this world. That's why they're shocked so much when you pray for them. We have concerns at work. A student might bring something up, and you know what? Say, can I pray for you? I can't remember the last time I had somebody say, well, I really don't appreciate you praying for me. I can't remember the last time I ever had that. You know, what I have had is them saying, hey, I appreciate that.
Yeah, right.
That's what I had. You know, and when you say, you know what? God loves you. God's got a plan for your life. Sometimes they step back and they say, God's got a plan for me. Some people don't know that. Because I'm telling you, I've seen a lot. And since I deal with students, you've seen people when they're this little, they've been told they never amount to nothing. Mm-hmm. When they're that little. So they're 4 and 5 years old. And as they come up, you'll never amount to nothing. Yeah. You're no good. You know, that's why I study biographies. You know, Michael Phelps, he had some issues growing up and stuff. And they never thought he amounted to nothing because he couldn't focus. But, you know, he found swimming. God led him to swimming. Yeah. And he's the greatest Olympian of all time. You know, that's why you never, ever say that to anybody. You don't know all the plans that God has for somebody.
Right.
You know, if you look in the Bible, you know, the people that God used, they was broken people. They weren't people that never, you know, probably the one that had probably the cleanest life of all was probably Daniel. You know, you don't really see him getting in a lot of trouble. But if you look at most of life's David, you look at Moses, you look at, man, they God used a lot of broken people.
Yes, amen.
But there's one thing about a broken people. I gotta share this. But the one thing I remember thinking about God using Moses, because I tell you what, Moses probably had to think God was done with him when he went on the backside of the desert. He probably had to think that. You know, like it's a few years. Yeah, well, God, you know, he was probably cute. But man, that first decade, where's God at? You know, man, I was really screwed up. You know, and when Moses had that opportunity when he went back home and his mom raised him, I'm sure his mom shared those things. God's got a plan for you, Moses. God's got a plan for you. And probably drilled in his head, but Moses tried to do it his way, but he had to do it God's way. So he had him out. God had him for 40 years. Can you imagine that? 4 decades out in the desert. But then one day, the burning bush. The burning bush. Because God sometimes has to get all the stuff out of us that's not like him, so we can be more like him and represent him.
Mm-hmm.
So I remember I used to go over Detroit, South Detroit, and we pick up these clay pots. And the clay pots, you put plants and stuff in. And what I loved, usually the owner was walking around. We didn't ever have to count nothing, because what they would do, we'd back in the dock, and they'd bring them out a conveyor belt, and they had an inspector right there at loading the box, and they would look at it. If it had one crack in it, they wouldn't ship it out. Because the time we got from Detroit back to the yard, they used to be little pieces. They'd be cracked in there. Time to go. So they couldn't have one crack. So they'd look, and some of them they'd throw in this big bin. And I'd see them throw in the big bin. I'm thinking, what are they going to do? So you go outside, and they took this big bin of cracked pots, and then they take it outside and dump it, and they go in a conveyor belt. And you know what? You'd see these little pieces going up there. You know what they do? They'd send them back in the factory, and they'd heat them up again, and they'd start them over. And they'd come just make this big cycle. They didn't waste anything. And I just remember seeing that, and I'm thinking, wow, that is what a picture. They weren't wasted. They wasn't ready yet, you know? And God used that time. They went back through the furnace and came back again, and one day was ready to ship out. And I thought about how powerful that is, that you know what? Sometimes we think that we can't be used because this happened to us or that happened to us life, and God says, nope, we're going back to the furnace. We're going to get ready. You know what? Because I still got a plan for you.
Yeah.
You know? And a lot of those plans of God in your life, you know where they start? They start on your knees. That's where they start. They start with spending that time with God and not forgetting that how much he loves you and me. Hallelujah. 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 We're going to open this testimony time up because it's always good to praise God. And everybody's got a reason to praise God. Praise God. You think about all the stuff going on in the United States. I mean, the fires and the floods and all the other things, you know. I'm telling you, there's so much to praise God. There's a lot of people. I was, you know, that news in California with the fires, and the guy was just sitting there, and the fire came up so quick. You know, they're fighting it with everything they got, and he's sitting on the curb, and he's watching all of his whole, you know, house, and it was a big farm, and he watching it all burn, you know. And I'm just saying, there's nothing he can do. I mean, there's not, you know, you can't put no holes on that. I mean, it was just engulfed, you know. And I see that, and sometimes you just see this drain out. But, you know, regardless if you lose all that, you still have God.
Amen.
Okay? And that's what this other lady said about the flood. She was saying, they said, well, you know, we lost this, but the family was able to get out. So the most precious, they were still, you know, you miss your pictures and you miss all that, but to have your family, you know, you can always start over when God's ahead of your family.
Right.
There's always a starting point. So tonight we want to take time to praise God. All right, hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Go ahead. Yes, Roberto.
I'm very thankful for everything that's happening, you know, in my life and here. I'm thankful for this church and all the testimonies that are shared and the word that is being preached. I'm also really excited about now us men coming together,
mm-hmm.
and we're going to start doing that. And I'm very eager to see what's going to come out of that ministry.
Yep.
So I'm very excited for that. And also, if we can pray for Myron, he's been going through a lot of pain lately. And,
yes.
You know, he's struggling a lot, and you can sense the desperation that he's going through with his pulse, you know.
Right.
He's really struggling. He's hanging in there and really wanting God to manifest in that situation so we can lift him up for healing.
Yes. Yeah, we're going to do that because I know a lot of his Facebook friends and stuff, and that's been something I've been doing start just saying prayers up. I send that a lot. Probably when people want prayers, they're going up now,
yeah,
you know,
exactly.
Because what we always want to look at, what if we were in that situation?
Right.
What if that was pain? I mean, I know we've all had some painful things, and I'm telling you, when you got a nagging pain, that, I mean, all the medicine don't just seem to take away. You can't sleep, and you can't. That just it can be a real issue, so that's what the church is for, to lift up one another, to pray. One of my favorite things I've been saying a lot here in about the last year, brother, because we're brothers. That's what we are, and brothers support brothers, and brothers support sisters. Okay, because we're all, you know, the family of God. That's what it's. They used to sing that song, the family of God, and that's what we are. We're a family, and family takes care of family.
Right.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Yes.
Can we call and ask for prayer for Dave Schick?
Okay.
Like a coworker
of hers. Okay. Okay. Yes. That's right.
Just trying to rely on and don't worry about stuff as much and just relax in his presence. And I understand that more as I've gotten back and I'm so thankful. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And you don't have that happen and leave from right there being living for a couple days and then he'll go back and they'll do surgery and this home made over here and help him for a little bit until he recuperates here and give him, you know, give him, I don't know, give him a speedy recovery and not as cumbersome as you think it would be.
Yeah.
Okay, amen. Yep, we'll definitely pray. And I asked a co-worker, we've just asked for his spouse, just some personal things. And that's what I love, just to be able to pray. And you know, let them know that we're going to pray about it. Because I think it's wrong when somebody asks you to pray, you know, and y'all, sure, I'll pray, and then you don't pray for them. That's why I write stuff down, because then you don't have to worry about forgetting. And I write a lot of stuff in the Bible. You know, and then I can remember to pray for them because I'm going to look in my Bible, you know. And then what's nice, I like to go back and find out what the answer was. You know, it's kind of nice, too, to put, hey, this prayer was answered, or ask how you doing. God moved. You know, God really blessed. Mm-hmm. I mean, my son, I continued to pray. He had a family situation. He called me and talked, and to see that prayer answer, you know, and put up, I'm blessed. To see people grow in the Lord, that is just a wonderful feeling. You know where they were at, but when they get that deeper, richer understanding of God, it's just amazing to see them grow and to see them lift up the hands. And they know. That's the thing I love about God. You know, when you see God do a miracle, you can't claim it as anything else.
That's right.
You know, that's what I love. I was just one day, you know, just God just puts a lot of stuff on your heart, and I remember just, you know, asking God for things, and sometimes you feel like you just ask him for so much stuff, you know, and you got all his requests. And as God was putting my heart, you know what, Tim, I'm a big God.
Yeah.
You can ask me for big things, you know. And I thought, wow. And there's nothing impossible to God. Is anything too hard for God? You know, and that's what we always got to remember. There's nothing. There's nothing. I remember my oldest sister, she used to tell me, I used to do that to Dad all the time. I thought my dad could do anything. You know, he could do anything. You just think he, no matter what. And he always would run to him when he got home. Dad, you bring me something? You bring me something? You bring me something? Because, you know, you had a relationship there. And you think to God, and I understand how important it is. You know, and it's nothing wrong with asking God. He rewards those who diligently seek him. But, you know, I think the best thing, too, is just go to him sometimes and don't ask for nothing. And just say, you know what, I love you.
Yeah.
I just want to tell you today, God, I love you, and I thank you for all that you've done for me.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I had a preacher that, when I lived here in Des Moines in the 80s, and he was preaching one day, and he says, you know what we ought to do? we ought to just reach out like this and hug God. You know, just give him a hug. Yeah. Sometimes he use a hug because a lot of stuff going on. But it's like, it's just everybody just reach out and hug God and tell him how much you love him. And I just remember, I could just see that picture. He had his arms. Let's hug God. Because you know what? God likes to hear that too. Because I tell you what, he likes to hear when you appreciate him and you thank him. Psalm 34:1, I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continue to be in my mouth. His praise, not my complaint, not this, says his praise. I tell you what, that praise will change a lot of situations around. Complaining, nobody likes to hear that. You know, belly aching. We used to call it belly aching. I'm telling you, it's old, brother. Let me tell you. Go belly ache to a cow or something. But you're going to keep belly aching to me because I serve a God that's bigger than that.
Amen.
You know, his name is above every name. Okay? So his name is above cancer. His name is above hurt. His name is above breakups. His name is above that. So that's what we need to look at all the time. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Yes.
I was reminded that, you know, take your burdens to the Lord and leave them there.
That's right. That's right.
Hallelujah.
Yeah.
Yeah, the other night, there was a situation, you know, and kind of an ongoing one. And then that talk came to me. And almost, like, are you sure he'll do something there? But I just put it all on here and left it there, and just, you know, I don't know when or how, but I'll leave this to the Lord. And, oh my, yes, he does. I mean, he answered in such a bountiful way.
Hallelujah.
That, you know, beyond my expectations.
Yep.
Praise the Lord.
Yeah, so just take your burdens to the Lord and leave them there.
That's
and
right.
Allow him to take care of it.
That's
allow
right.
Allow him to take care of it.
That's a great thing to bring out. It's a privilege to carry everything of God in prayer. When you take it to prayer and just keep lifting God up. You know, that's the thing. Lift him up. You know, you think about the one that called the world into existence, just spoke. Said, star, tell you what, you're going to stay there. You're going to stay there. The shore, you're going to stop right here. A God that powerful can surely handle what's going on in your life.
Yeah.
And sometimes we get to think the problem is a lot bigger than God can ever handle. It ain't going to happen. You know, like we say today, I got it. God saying to you, he got it.
Yeah.
You say, I got this. I got this. I got this. And you can hear the cry of Jesus' heart when he walked to earth. It's just like his cry. It's just, I wish they just believed me more.
Yeah.
That's why he was always, when somebody had faith, it was like, wow, it's like his face lit up. They get it. Yeah. They understand it.
Yeah.
That's what we always got to remember. You know, they think about Jesus in heaven. And then Jesus coming down here, he knows all the things. He was a baby once. He understands all that. He understands. He had people desert him. He understands. You know, he understands what it is to have tears down your cheek. But he also said, I have overcome the world.
Yeah.
You know? And so many times he would say, angels would say, fear not, fear not, fear not. You know, he wanted us to just look at him as the one can handle it. Because God can. Hallelujah.
Amen.
And never forget that. That's what something has been on my heart. Never forget how big God is. He wouldn't have put those words. The Bible said, for with God, all things are possible. It didn't say, it didn't say this. You know, just some things are possible. All things are possible. Is anything too hard for God? Well, anything covers a lot of territory, doesn't it? Okay? That means what it says. Then the Bible said anything, that means anything. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Yes.
Seeing in the spirit realm.
Praise the Lord.
Lord.
Praise the Lord. So many talents. So many talents. God uses us all. Everybody's got a talent. Everybody's got a purpose. Anybody else? Okay. Let's stand, please, for prayer. And Father God, we thank you tonight. We thank you that you are such a great God. How you love us, God. Let us never forget that. Oh, sometimes we just feel like we're so weighted down with problems. How can I make it? Which way should I go? Well, you made it plain. You said you are the way, the truth, and the life. That's the way I should go. God, we realize you are the wonderful counselor, mighty God, our Savior. You are the divine healer. You can provide for us when it seems like there's no way we can make it. But with God, you can always make it. It's all about in the beginning, God. That's where it started at. How far does that go back? It goes back in the beginning. Way back. And God knew us before we was formed in the mom's belly. He already called us. He had a plan for us. And Lord, that plan is to give us a future and a hope. Father God, today we ask you to be with Myron, our brother, that pain will stop, Lord. Lord, we ask you to touch him tonight from the top of his head, the sole of his feet, touch his whole body. We know that, Lord, it's been an ongoing thing, but we're still claiming it, that total healing, because you are more than able. Hallelujah. And Tammy's friend, Dave Schick, Lord, we're going to pray for those situations there, Lord, with Dave and all that. Just go, Lord, that you would just go and whatever the situation, that you would just turn everything around. And with Joe that broke his bones, Lord, that you would move in that situation. Because, Lord, you are more than able. Lord, that you would touch our families, touch our friends. Lord, touch the people that we come in contact with, that they can see, why do you act different? There's something different about you. Seem like your face lights up. You're not always dragging things down. You're talking about a holy God that can illuminate a life. Father God, that's what it's all about. All those needs that are here, we thank you for how you're working in Roberto's life and the different members of the church life. And we thank you that we can come to you. We thank you that when we come to you, we can just bear all our concerns, everything to you. But Lord, we want to also come tonight and say, you know what? We're coming to praise you. We're coming to thank you. We're coming to believe you for greater and greater things. That you got so much in store for us if we'd only keep believing and not give up. Lord, the best way to get is by praising you. Lord, that we can get closer to you. That's what it's all about. Paul said that I may know him. That's what it's about, to know you. To realize that your word's forever settled in heaven. Lord, that from the beginning of time, Lord, you had it all planned out. That, hallelujah, that you would come and be our sacrifice. And you're just asking us to accept that sacrifice. Accept everything you've done on the cross. And realize you did it for us. Let us never forget how good you are. And Father God, as we go into the service tonight, let your Holy Spirit have the right of way. That lives will be changed. That when we leave, we won't leave the same way we came. Because our hearts are going to be bigger and bigger and bigger and more dedicated to your cause and your way. And we want to thank you tonight because you're a good and powerful and holy God. In Jesus Christ's name. Amen, amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm going to go ahead and turn off your phones there, if you would. Thank you. Okay? And we're going to speak the word. Okay? Will you not revive us again that your people may rejoice in you? I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons. I speak in new tongues. I lay hands on the sick, and they do recover. Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ and every tissue of this body functions to the perfection to which God created to function. And I forbid any malfunction in this body in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. I receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of Him, the eyes of my understanding being enlightened, and I am not conformed to this world, but am transformed by the renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the word of God. Hallelujah. The Lord rebukes the devourer for my sake, and no weapon that is formed against my finances will prosper. All obstacles and hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved. The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of his servants, and Abraham's blessings are mine. Hallelujah. 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 And Brother Ron, would you come up and take the offering, please? You may be seated. Bless you.
Always,
I bless you for the opportunity.
As we were praying, my phone vibrated. It was Myron. We were already praying for him, so we knew to pray for him before he even got the message. And even Shelly told him he shouldn't be driving. Other people told him to drive while in the midst of the message. Link and Associates said he cannot drive while he's taking his medication.
Oh.
So they're making him listen to what he needs to do, because his leg being down, being immobile pretty much while you're driving is aggravating his healing.
Yeah.
So he might be upset about it, but he needs to take care of that, complete the healing. And also he's praying for finances and stuff, because since he's not working, he has no income. Mm-hmm. So we'll just pray for and continue praying for him in that situation also.
Yes.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
The Lord says in all things praise him. So that's what we're going to do. We're going to praise that he's been healed. We're going to praise that all the answered prayers have come forth. So thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus. Father, we just bless you tonight. Thank you, Lord, for your presence, for your faithfulness. Thank you for your love. Thank you, Lord, for revealing yourself to us, for showing yourself mighty on our behalf. We just bless you tonight, Lord. We want to lift you up, to magnify you, to exalt you, Lord. You are the only one who deserves all the praise and all the worship that we can give. You are a great and a mighty God, and there's none like you. We just bless your name tonight, Lord, and ask you to just have your way in Jesus' mighty name. And everybody said, praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Amen. Give him a hand clap. Praise
God.
Praise God. God bless you. You may be seated. Thank you, Tim. Appreciate it. As always, great job. Hallelujah. And Mike and worship team, thanks as always again. Great job. Praise the Lord. God is good, isn't he?
Amen.
Hallelujah. Good to have James back.
Amen.
Sound like he had a good time and got to minister and get ministered to, right? It's a good thing. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. That was a set out of my diamond that fell on the floor. Hallelujah. All right, we'll get right to the Word of God tonight. Amen. We want to start with 2 Corinthians chapter 5. And I want to read verses 16 through 21. 2 Corinthians 5, verses 16 through 21. Now, while we were talking, I was thinking that you know, one of the biggest challenges is that when we get discouraged, you know, if you've been sick over a period of time or had a financial situation that gets drawn out, you know, and it's easy to begin to doubt. Now, I just say this, that doubt isn't necessarily a bad thing, because if we take advantage of it, if we're wise enough to use doubt to draw us to God rather than to drive us away from God. So in other words, if anybody that's ever had a prolonged situation that hasn't been resolved in the way that we felt like it should, in the way that the Word of God says it will, then we should use that doubting that comes, that anxiety, that questioning of whether God will or won't, or why hasn't he, and you know, where is he in all of this, to take us back to God rather than to drive us away from him. Trouble is, too many people run away from God because they don't get the answer they want when they want it. But if you'd go back to the Word of God, find where God has made these promises and dwell on that, meditate on that, pray about that, confess that, all of a sudden God becomes bigger and bigger and bigger. Not that he's ever shrunk any, but in our own minds, because we haven't seen him move the way we wanted him to move when we thought he should move, amen, it causes doubt. But doubt can be a positive thing if we use it in a positive way. Go back to find out why God said what he said, when he said it, how he said it, for whom he said it. Amen? And you start to see God becoming more and more real, where the devil tries to make him, because of circumstances, try to shrink God down and make him seem less or unconcerned or angry with you or whatever it might be. So praise the Lord. Just use doubt against the enemy. Instead of letting him use it against you, you just use it against him. Praise the Lord. Okay, 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 16 through 21. Wherefore henceforth know we no man after the flesh. Yea, though we have known Christ after the flesh, yet now henceforth know we him no more. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. And all things are of God, who hath reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ, and hath given to us the ministry of reconciliation. To wit, that God was in Christ, reconciling the world unto himself, not imputing their trespasses unto them, and hath committed unto us the word of reconciliation. Now then, we are ambassadors for Christ, as though God did beseech you by us. We pray you in Christ's stead, be ye reconciled to God. For he hath made him to be sin for us, who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in Him. So, praise the Lord. Now, I believe that first and foremost, above everything else, Jesus came to pay the penalty for our sins. But I also believe that He came to model for us how to live life the way that it was meant to be. If we'll be led by the Spirit, He shows us how to find satisfaction, fulfillment, and it's not found in striving, it's not found in working and forcing, but it's found in enjoying God. Exactly what Tim was talking about tonight, and in fact, the testimonies all point to this as well. There's a way to be satisfied in God, even when circumstances aren't lining up the way they should. And it's by trusting in God. It's by enjoying the goodness of God. I'm going to use this John chapter 5 as kind of just a outline for what I want to talk to you briefly about tonight. John chapter 5, and let's read verses 1 through 15, Mike. John 5, 1 through 15. This is a familiar story. It's about the pool of Bethesda, the man that needs to be healing. Amen. Healed. And so after this, there was a feast of the Jews, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. And there is at Jerusalem by the sheep market a pool which is called in the Hebrew tongue Bethesda, having five porches. In these lay a great multitude of impotent folk, of blind, halt, withered, waiting for the moving of the water. For an angel went down at a certain season into the pool and troubled the water. Whosoever then first after the troubling of the water stepped in it was made whole of whatever disease he had. And a certain man was there which had an infirmity 38 years. When Jesus saw him lie and knew that he had been now a long time in that case, he saith unto him, Wilt thou be made whole? The impotent man answered, Sir, I have no man when the water is troubled to put me into the pool. But while I'm coming, another steppeth down before me. Jesus saith unto him, Rise, take up thy bed, and walk. And immediately the man was made whole, and took up his bed, and walked. And on the same day was the Sabbath. The Jews therefore said unto him that was cured, It's the Sabbath day, it's not lawful for thee to carry thy bed. He answered them, He that made me whole, the same said unto me, Take up thy bed and walk. Then asked they him, What man is that which said unto thee, Take up thy bed and walk? And he was healed, he that was healed, wist not who it was, for Jesus had conveyed himself away, a multitude being in that place. Afterward, Jesus findeth him in the temple, and said unto him, Behold, thou art made whole, sin no more, lest a worse thing come unto thee. The man departed, and told the Jews that it was Jesus which had made him whole. So, what's, odd to me, or funny, I guess, in a way, is that when we read these ancient scriptures, ancient Bible stories like this, we have a tendency to kind of idolize the situation or the circumstances, or at least I do. We kind of imagine that it's neat, it's orderly, it's rows of people lounging on poolside, with a cold beverage, praise the Lord. And when the angel stirs this beautiful, pristine, crystal clear water, all the lame and the paralyzed and the blind look at each other and say, You first, you've been here longer than I have. Praise the Lord. Yeah. And one at a time, they all get up and get healed. It's really more like a Christmas Eve. I remember back when my second daughter was young and we were trying to find a Cabbage Patch doll. Yes. Sally eventually made one for her because they were sold out. But it was kind of like standing in line to get that last whatever toy everybody's wanting. It's chaos. It's every man for himself. Praise the Lord. If you've ever gone Christmas shopping on Christmas Eve, that was one of my fatal... I used to always wait till the last minute to do it, and thinking I was going to get in the spirit. It usually took me till the first of the year to get over my raging mania. But can you imagine the tension that had to be around that pool? The scripture says there's a great multitude of people. Now, I don't know how many that is, but it had to be hundreds. They were packed. Desperate, hurting people. And every last one is thinking, maybe this is going to be my time to be healed. It's dog eat dog. It's a culture of chaos.
It's disorder, it's stress, it's tension, it's anxiety. And everybody's trying to take advantage and beat the other ones who are also in need. And if you look at this a little closer, I believe what the Lord is showing us is that this man represents us, you and me. This pool is our planet and the people that are on it. We are that man. Jesus asked the man by the pool, "Do you want to be made well?" Of course, the obvious answer is, of course. What do you think I'm doing here? Are you kidding? But the man points to a situation. He's sick for nearly 40 years. He has no one to help him get ahead in life. He's had a lot of almost successes. Just close enough to disappoint and to discourage. But somehow, somebody always beats him into the healing. Someone is always faster. Somebody's always smarter. Somebody's always more ruthless to get what they need ahead of the needs that he has. Now, I talk to a lot of people over the course of just in a week, probably at least two or three people, sometimes more than that. Counseling, I don't really call it counseling because I usually just listen more than anything else. But the truth is, everybody's kind of in this place. If not right to now, at some point you were, or at some point you probably will be. Isn't that life on this planet? The struggle, the stress, the angst, all that Tim was talking about, all the issues that are going on in the world, and most of it's because of that. These things happen out of people pushing and struggling and trying to be successful, trying to get what it is they need ahead of somebody else, thinking that if I don't get mine before they get theirs, I won't get any. Most people live with incredible tension because they think that their dreams will come true if I can just get the right degree, if I can just meet the right people, if I could just get the right job, not the job I got, but another job, a better job, a different job. Assuming that our happiness is tied to success, and our success depends on our performance. So we sweat and we struggle and we scheme and we strategize and we wonder why we don't enjoy life. Ba-boom. Praise the Lord. Yeah, I'm not trying to be depressing. I'm telling you, God came to set us free. Mm-hmm. Do you want to be made well? Jesus asked the guy. Well, he says, I've tried, but it just hasn't worked out for me. Can't tell you how many people, just in the last week, that I've talked to about needing deliverance, they're needing healing, they're needing a different job, they're needing some other situation. And you say that God wants to do this, God wants to bless you. And they're going, yeah, but I've come this close so many times and it doesn't happen. Something goes upside down, something goes sideways, something happens. And Jesus just says, get up right now. Now, I have a problem sometimes dealing with people because I empathize with their issues and with their problems and with their struggles because, hey, I've had them and I will probably continue to have them as long as I'm on this planet. But sometimes you just want to say, hey, pick up your mat and walk, man. I mean, come on, it's time to get out and step out in faith and do something besides complain. I mean, I'm not against, I understand the reason that we speak out in pain and hurting and so on and so forth. But sometimes, man, you got to just get up and go. Sometimes you got to just take a step of faith. We hear all the time, the just shall live by faith. What part of that don't we get? Ooh. Walking by faith means you don't have a lot of evidence to keep you walking. That's why it's called faith. Amen. If you can feel the healing, if you can experience the breakthrough, then you don't need faith. All you need to do is just walk out whatever it is that's going on in your life. Get up right now. Pick up your mat. Walk away free, healed and happy. That's what Jesus is saying.
Yes.
The guy's dream isn't fulfilled by jockeying his way to the top.
Right.
It's not in pushing his way to the front. It's in Jesus. It's in finding Jesus. Get up. He said, sure, it's easy for you to say. I've tried to get up for 38 years. You ever feel like that?
Mm-hmm.
Somebody tells you, God wants to bless you. And you're thinking, can't be that easy. You know how many years I've tried to improve myself? You know how many years I've tried to improve my situation or my circumstance or the issues that I'm dealing with? You know how many years I've tried to go after my dreams? You can't just tell me to get up. You can't just tell me to believe. But the man gets up. How and why, after all this time, does this guy respond? Does he feel something in his body? Does he feel an unction? Does he feel compelled by some internal, inexplicable no? K-N-O-W? No. He simply gets up based on what God said. Mm-hmm. He simply takes what Jesus said and acts on it. Mm-hmm. And now he's doing something he's only dreamed about his whole life. In a moment, after one simple, illogical invitation by Jesus, everything changes.
Yes.
I think this guy realized he didn't have any other choice.
Right.
He'd been trying it his way, the natural way, for 38 years and nothing has changed. His way isn't working, and it never will. He's at the end of himself, and Jesus offers him another way.
Right.
That's what we're doing with people. You know, sometimes I think when it sounds overly simplistic when you tell somebody God loves you, God wants to bless you, God has a plan for your life, a purpose for your life. We know that to be true based on what the Word of God says, based on our own experiences. But to other people, it's like 38 years in the world, man, struggling, fighting, clawing, doing whatever I can to try to, and I'm not getting there. I'm just, you know, why hasn't God done something for me before? Why hasn't, you know, somebody, you know, boosted me up? Why hasn't somebody done something for me? And what's crazy is how the other people respond when he does get up.
Mm-hmm.
They've seen this guy for almost 40 years in the same condition. They know his situation. They know they couldn't do anything for him. And what's remarkable, what's actually even overwhelming, is that because these people are so fixated on the law, they can't celebrate the man's victory.
Right.
They can't deal with him standing and walking when he has been completely devastated his entire life. Man, I mean, when God moves in somebody's life, I don't care how wretched it is, their life, how messed up they are, how screwed up they are, we ought to be celebrating, we ought to be shouting the victory, we ought to be jumping up and down and dancing with them and walking with them and helping them carry the mat. Amen. If God's going to do it for them, he's no respecter of persons. Amen. He wants to bless them. We may have our own little personal peeves and pet peeves when it comes to certain sin and certain things, but I'm telling you, when God moves, everybody in the body of Christ ought to be celebrating, just like the angels in heaven are. They're not judging, was this a big deal for God, or was this just a little thing that God had to do? No, they're just celebrating that another person has been written in the Lamb's Book of Life. There's another one on their way to heaven, and that one person can then impact hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of other people through their own testimony, through their own life. Amen? John chapter 5, let's just read verses 12 and 13 this time. Praise the Lord, Cindy.
Yay.
It's great seeing you back there. Hallelujah. God is good. Amen. So then asked they him, what man is that which said unto thee, take up thy bed and walk? And he said, he that was healed wist not who it was. And Jesus had conveyed himself away from a multitude being in that place. So the guy doesn't even know who healed him. He doesn't even know who this was. The guy doesn't know who did it. Verse 14 says, afterward Jesus findeth him in the temple and said unto him, behold, thou art made whole. Sin no more, lest a worse thing come unto thee. This guy isn't on the celebrity A list. He's been there 38 years trying to get this thing.
Right.
Amen. He's not on the B list. He's not on any list.
Mm-hmm.
He's just a guy with all kinds of problems.
Right.
Amen. We don't even know his name.
Nope.
Talk about not a respecter of persons. This isn't like some guy, he's building him up to be this great man of faith. We don't even know who the guy is. He's just some guy with 38 years of grief and pain and suffering that Jesus just steps out and touches. Jesus hunts him down a second time.
Yep.
Says, oh, by the way, my name is Jesus.
Yeah, there you go.
Why? Because this wasn't as much about healing as it was about the man himself. He needed healing, but he needed something else much more than that. He needed to know the love of God.
Yes.
He needed to know that God was aware of his situation, that God cared about the situation, that God wanted to do something about that situation. Jesus didn't just want the guy to walk. He wanted him to know Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes I think in our desire to see people delivered and to see people healed, we forget the ultimate purpose here is to get them to know Jesus. To get them to experience the reality of a God that loves them, that will hunt them down, that will spend a life pursuing them, that they might be saved, that they might be made whole, that they might know there is a God and that God loves them.
Amen.
Jesus, the source of all satisfaction. Amen?
Amen.
The source of all satisfaction is to know God. Without that, everything else is haywire anyhow. Verse 14 again, if you can, Mike. Afterward, Jesus findeth him in the temple, said unto him, Behold, thou art made whole. Sin no more, lest a worse thing come unto thee. Jesus is telling this guy, you need to look to me. Not just for physical healing, great as it is, as miraculous as it was, but for salvation from the real problem, which is sin, which has separated you from your God.
Mm-hmm.
And Jesus is saying, you need me. I'm the answer, not only to your healing, but I'm the answer to your sin.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
Not trying harder, not being more dedicated, which is nothing wrong with either of those things, but simply following the sinless Savior. God wants us healed. God wants us happy. God wants us pain-free. But the truth is, life's a lot bigger than a few decades spent on this planet. God wants us to be eternally happy, to be eternally healed, to be eternally blessed, to be eternally fulfilled. For him to be our God eternally. You know, you look at the news, and I mean, we've all seen these things over the years. People that have everything. I mean, they've got good health, lots of money, prestige. Everybody knows them, but it's not satisfying. Why? Because it's not eternal. Everybody knows this is temporary.
Amen.
No matter how much we try to avoid that, no matter how much we try not to think about it, the truth is we're only here for a certain amount of time. Amen. So you can have everything there is to have in this life and still be miserable because you know that there's something waiting beyond this life. That all the stuff you got in this life is not going to help. It's not going to prepare you for what's coming.
Right.
So the last verse in this story shows the power of a changed life. Not just a healing, but a life that's been changed.
Yes.
Because he says he found out it was Jesus. And he told the Jews that it was Jesus which had made him whole.
Amen.
He starts immediately sharing what Christ has done for him. The man who was healed is telling everybody about Jesus. He understands. He gets it. The story isn't about healing. The story is about the healer.
Yes.
The guy has moved from stressful, tense, every man for himself, chaotic environment to a place of freedom.
Thank you, Lord.
A place of rest.
Yes.
A place of confidence.
Amen.
a new way of doing life.
Yes.
This new life that we have in Christ. It's not a renovation. It's not a remodel. It's not an upgrade. It's not an addition. It's not an accessory. It's the new creation. It's a new world. It's a new system. And we have access to it through Jesus Christ. 2 Corinthians 5:17 again. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. It's a new thing. He makes all things new. I mentioned it Sunday. Sally and I were talking about it on the way home. You know, I have notes. I always have notes. But there's always things that come out in the midst of the message that are not in my notes. They're just what happens. And that was one of those things. You know, we all think that, you know, God's going to do this new thing. There's something other supernatural thing that God's going to do that no one has ever seen before. But if you go back through the Old Testament and you read everywhere he talks about the new thing is us.
Come on.
The new thing that God keeps talking about that he's going to do is he's going to come and live in men. No longer in a temple, no longer separate, just moving upon people, but he's actually going to come and live inside of us. That's the new creation. That's the new creature. That's the new thing. Amen? Because that new thing is what releases the Ancient of Days into this world.
Thank you, Lord.
It makes it right now. It makes it new every day. The creation is new, and everything in it is new. Everything about it is new. It's a new world. It's a new way. It's a new life. It's a new way of God expressing himself to humanity.
Amen.
He makes all things new.
Yes.
Praise God. It's like saying, it's not his will that any should perish, but that all should be made new.
Yes.
Praise God. Matthew chapter 11, last scripture here. Matthew 11, 28 through 30. We sang about this earlier. We talk about it a lot, but it's because it needs to be talked about. Come unto me, all you that labor and heavy laden, right? That's the world we live in. That's life. That's where this guy was for 38 years. Come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. In other words, he's saying, all you that are in the old world, come to the new world. Amen? Take my yoke upon you. Learn of me, for I'm meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall have find rest unto your souls. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light. Praise God. So maybe we, you know, when we approach people, and we need to think about it for ourselves as well, but especially with other people, they're tired of the mayhem. They're tired of the craziness. They're tired of the chaos around the pool, the struggling to survive. Conquering in a hostile environment, doing things in their own strength, with their own resources. Come to me, Jesus says, and I'll show you a whole new world. I'll show you a whole new life. The kingdom of God has come, not just to you, but in you.
Amen.
The new thing. You become righteous. Christ in you, the hope of glory. People need to know there's another way. There's a better way, a new way, a way that will forever transform their lives for eternity, not just for the now, not just for the moment, not just for this particular crisis, but forever.
Amen.
And it's life in Christ. It's being led by his Spirit. It's enjoying the freedom in this world, where there seems to be no freedom.
Right.
And yet we can live in the middle of all the chaos around the pool, all this grabbing and scrounging and trying to get ahead. We can live at peace in the midst of all of that because of the new you, because of the Christ that's in you.
Yes.
And that's what people are looking for. One person like Jesus that just steps up and says, you don't have to be like this anymore. Just get up and walk out of it. See that there's a God waiting there with open arms to give you a new you, a new life, a new world.
Mm-hmm.
Can you say praise the Lord?
Praise
Amen.
The Lord.
Give him a hand clap tonight. Hallelujah. Praise God. Amen. God is good. He makes all things new.
Amen.
Praise God. Let's enjoy the new things. Amen.
Amen.
In Jesus. God bless you. You're dismissed in Jesus' name. Hope we'll see you back here Sunday. Have a great rest of the week. Enjoy the new you. It's looking good from here. Praise God.